adaptation in this university, at the Hogeschool Rotterdam, at other universities. For example, many of you today are developing new thoughts, new ideas on how to handle sea level rise, more extreme discharges along our coast, based also on thoughts of our, how do you say that, the old hydraulic engineers that lived almost a century ago. I think there is a need to confront our thoughts and ideas more with the general audience, with the general public, but also with each other. And that's why I developed a proposal that it would be nice to develop a facility, can be virtual, can be partly physical, where we can do research, where we can share our thoughts and ideas on what should the Netherlands look like in face of climate change and in face of sea level rise, more higher river discharges, longer periods of drought. And basically, that is a challenge we are proposing to our students, and not only the students of TU Delft, but students also from other universities, universities of applied sciences. And the opportunity that arose was that, and my colleague Michael van der Meer will tell more about that in a few minutes, is that we are also actually going to redevelop the science center, the science communication facility of the TU Delft. And in that new science center, we will have a room that is dedicated to climate adaptation of deltas. So what we're basically looking for are proposals on what should that room look like? What facility would enable you as students to share your ideas, to start dialogues also with public on the viability or the desirability of your ideas, but also with each other? So for example, if a hydraulic engineer has developed new sea level rise projections, and how to confront that with the designs of a landscape designer. How are we going to create such an environment in the facility? We already have a lot of facilities here at TU Delft. You've probably all visited once the Waterlog with all our hydraulic flumes. We have a lot of things we can do with computers, but we lack a little bit of projection facility where we can bring that all together, or where we can have physical scale models combined with projections of the more computational models. So that's something we're looking for. And it's also a place where we can kind of store all the research that we have. So where we can store maybe our designs for the new coastlines, where we can store our computational outcomes. And with store, I mean also in a visible way. Don't know who has already visited the Boijmans van Beuning depot? Would be nice to have such a facility where we can also store all our thoughts and ideas on how to handle climate change. The challenge looks as follows. So today we're launching, or this week we're launching it, and we are going to share with you our thoughts and ideas. That's why I brought also two colleagues who I will introduce later. And if you think, oh, that's interesting, I would like to design such a facility. The task is to form a team, preferably a multidisciplinary team, because I think you need it. You will need a combination of different disciplines to come up with something. And then the first thought is to write an expression of interest. Basically, that's a short note where you say, okay, I like it. I'm up to this challenge. I would like to come and visit once the room that we foresee in the future. We have, for the people that are interested in contribute, that we have a small voucher to supply them with maybe some material to build some first prototypes, but also maybe some pizza to support first brainstorming sessions. That's about 500 euros. And then we will select the expressions of interest, and we will select a couple of them, five finalists, and they will enter stage two. And they will interact more with us, with Michael van der Meer, the director of the Science Center, with me, to see what the facility will actually look like. We pitch them, and then in January and July, the winning team will interact with professional exhibition designers on the actual challenge. So that is what I wanted to say about the general outline of the challenge. And to give you some more context on why we want to have this facility and why we want to have it now, I've asked the two people that developed the challenge with me together to also speak today. And that will be first Michael van der Meer, the director of the Science Center at TU Delft. And after that, Henk Nieboer, and he is the director of EcoShape and has a long resume apart from that. And he will tell you more about the importance of climate adaptation, but also the importance of communication in that aspect. So, Michael, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, Martina already told you the most important part. The Science Center Delft considers itself as the gateway of the TU Delft, of the university, of all the knowledge and the people to a wider public. And a wider public is not only all the people regarded in the Netherlands, but also beyond, because we also have a virtual facility. This is the old building. And it consists, of an interactive presentation, which probably a lot of you know, or maybe not know, but where you can push all kinds of buttons and see what kind of research has been doing in the TU Delft. But foremost, we are a place of dialogue, because we want to present everything within the TU Delft to the public and have a discussion about it. Because we think here in the university of many solutions to societal problems. We design all kinds of machines, but it's only an innovation when it's accepted by a larger society. So everything we think of here, all kinds of ideas, we test, we discuss, we debate with the public. And we're not doing that alone. And we use all kinds of facilities we have in the TU Delft. And you saw here, we're in the Dream Hall. We use that place as a place of discussion. We take the objects there and we present it to the public. And we also invite students who design, for instance, this robot. This is the first version of AVA, designed by the Robot Institute. And we organize an event and we discuss with the public, we demonstrate what is going on. But we also incorporate the minors or master courses within the Science Center. And here you see students building actively in the Science Center in discussion with the public about what they designed, and they explaining why they do what they do and what is the use for society. And the public comments on that. And we also invite other groups into the Science Center, so they can organize their activities in the Science Center and explain what they are doing with technology, with science. And this is very practical. This is Repair Café Delft. And they organize sessions in repairing all kinds of household machines and communicate actively the why it's needed that we have a sustainable society and not throwing everything away, but reuse it, repair it. They connect also with the university. They were engaged in an European research program about sustainability and about demands we've got to put to manufacturers of household machines so that machines can be repaired. So their knowledge has been incorporated in university knowledge. And as a result, there was a report to the European Union about conditions we've got to put to manufacturers of household machines. And that's where this challenge comes in, because you are asked to design something about climate adaptation and mitigation. That is a starting point for our discussion with the wider public. And if the solutions we come up with is acceptable, or maybe it can be tweaked by the audience. So your results, and as well as yourselves, can be part of a wider communication set up in the Science Center. So I'm looking forward to the results and you come up with the ideas you come up with, and and that we can put them in place in the new Science Center, because now in the process of renewing our entire facility, also we're actually going to move to this building. And one of the major themes of the new exhibition will be climate and climate action. So your ideas, your results can be an important aspect of the new Science Center. So I want to
thanks, Michael. Yes.
To hang.
Yeah, and you already see one of the challenges there, right? Because bringing things to the human scale might be quite easy for things like robotics, but when we're considering about adapting a whole country or a whole world for that matter with more large scale interventions and how to bring that back to the person, that is, I think, one of the challenges we will have with designing this particular exhibition. Other questions already? Okay, now this was more the let's say the challenge side of it, and now I move to Henk, who gives more will make content to this talk. Yeah.
Maybe a less challenging presentation.
No, who knows? And so, questions can also be raised during the talk.
Yeah, thank you for having me here. I would like to shed some light on why we need such a facility and why an outsider like me, I don't work for TU Delft, I studied here. I graduated in 87, so that's a long time ago. In the building where never anything changes, the building of civil engineering, because you still have the same flooring, etc., the same atmosphere, which I think is great. So the renovation can be postponed, from my opinion, for some time to come. After that, I joined the company Witte Van den Bosch. In 87, and I left it in 2019. I worked there for 32 years. That was never the plan, but there was never a reason to leave until then. And after that, I started my own career for my own company, Adelta. I'm a self-employed professional in the field of climate adaptation, especially along coasts and rivers. And I try to promote the use of nature-based solutions, because I'm also the director of the EcoSharing Foundation, which is managing the public-private innovation program Building with Nature, on the supervisory board of Deltares. And because I did a lot of work in Kazakhstan, I was also asked to become the honorary consul of the Republic of Kazakhstan. But that's, in the light of this presentation, of no importance at all. I will tell you a little bit about the work of EcoShape, because it leads to why we need facilities like the one that has been proposed here. In EcoShape, we develop the concept of building with nature for the hydraulic infrastructures sector. And what we do is develop a new way of designing and constructing hydraulic infrastructure in such a way that we make use of the forces of nature to benefit economy, society, and the environment. And bring together various sectors, so public, private sector, NGOs, knowledge institutes, with a shared ambition, and make them work together. And in my opinion, that is a very important success factor of the program, and also should be applied in many more knowledge development programs. We have 12 years of experience now in implementing these concepts, building with nature, nature-based solutions in practice. And we built them, pilots, actual projects, and we measured, monitored them, and learned how they work. Translated it into design guidelines, and everything that we do is aimed at upscaling and replication. And we also developed a theory what is needed for upscaling and replication of these concepts, which also can be of great use in climate adaptation. And we have identified 6 enablers that we need to work on. We need to develop more technology and system knowledge. We need to be able to work in a multi-stakeholder environment and make our work communicable to other people, other stakeholders, and involve them in the design process. Novel management, monitoring and maintenance practices are needed. Institutional embedding is important. Business case, who pays, what are the benefits and what are the costs of these solutions and capacity building. And the facility that is proposed here is, in my opinion, can have a very important contribution to 3 of these enablers, which is the multi-stakeholder approach. You can use it to work with stakeholders to discuss about your solutions, to visualize them. Capacity building, of course, we can teach people how these concepts work. We can also bring other disciplines to the table. And institutional embedding, because we can show institutional embedding is about making the institutes that are running our society work together around a certain topic. It's very difficult because they are all organized as silos with a specific task, but you need communication means to make them work together, and this facility can be very important for that. So, what other purposes could it serve? It can also help ourselves as experts, because if you look at what's going on, climate change, of course, and so that results in changing boundary conditions for our designs, more extreme floods, droughts, at sea level rise. The thing is, we don't know exactly what's going to happen, because there are several scenarios for sea level rise in the IPCC report. And what will come out of it is influenced by how successful we are in mitigating our CO2 emissions, but also on what the ice in Antarctica will do. And to cope with that, everywhere people are making up their mind, what we could do, what we should do, and there's an enormous amount of creativity goes into all kinds of long-term scenarios and plans. I must say that I took most of these from an old mail that I found in my mailbox about Panorama Nederland. And so there are very many options to deal with these new conditions. And if I look at most of these, I must say I don't like them at all. So we need tools to come up with better ideas. What I like most is the Wageningen plan, but because it's always also because it's relatively modest, I think. The only disadvantage of that plan is that I will have to move out of my house. And when I told that to the people of Wageningen, they gave the usual reaction that you normally get from civil servants, that is, yeah, but it's only a plan on a high level. And of course, when we are going to zoom in, there will be lots of moments that you can bring in your views, and we will take that into account. And then in the end, you will see an optimized plan. I've said that many times myself. So there is creativity and hope in these plans, but there's also desperation. You see people, the general public, many people, they don't have the tools to think about what can we do? Can we do something? And that leads to desperation. Because if you read about the effects of climate change day after day in the newspaper, you simply have no idea that there are people like you who are creative minds that are going to solve lots of these issues, maybe not all, but then you start feeling desperate and you take to the streets. And uncertainty. And because I already said there are many scenarios for sea level rise, and I took this figure from a recent blog of Hessel Voortman. This was a very nice blog about sea level rise that he wrote. This is what was predicted before 2005, the rate of sea level rise along the Dutch coast. These two. There were two scenarios that were predicted in 2005. This is what happened. And this is what IPCC now projects for various scenarios. But yeah, we are still looking at this. And we roughly know why it is a little bit lower, why it is much lower than what was predicted. But if you go into that detail, you get a little bit frightened because sea level rise is, of course, determined by thermal expansion of the sea and by the rate of where the land ice is melting. But it's also determined by regional effects, which are very hard to quantify, which is, for instance, that we have had much more eastern winds over the last decades than before. That's also a factor of climate change. But can we count on that to continue? We don't know. And so there is a lot of uncertainty to deal with. And therefore, we have to think in also in the solutions, in scenarios, but also pathways. When do we take which decision? At what moment? And these pathways, they will lead us to a future for the Netherlands. This is work by Deltares. This is the sea level rise as it develops, and these are the moments when we have to decide this level, you have to decide something, etc. And it leads to different futures where we can still choose what to do. Accommodate sea level rise, close our coast, live in a half protected, a half open coast, or accommodate, which is also known under the name retreat. But how can we bring this all together, and how can we make it communicable? Climate change, sea level rise, extreme weather, uncertainty and outcomes, enormous amount of potential solutions and coping strategies, and also how can we make people curious about it and unleash creativity and also create hope for the future? I think that this proposed community can be very important for that. And yeah, that's also. I would like to thank you for your attention, of course. But I also would like to say, why am I here? I told you, I worked at Witte Van den Bosch. I was on the board of directors. I stepped down in 2017 and left in 2019. And then, as a gift of appreciation, I got a check from my colleagues, and they said, you have a certain amount of money which you can spend on fundamental research in climate adaptation at TU Delft. And I got that because I asked for that. I was saying, so they asked me, what do you want to have? And I said, hey, just keep it. And in January, we invited several people from TU Delft to make a proposal. And I liked the proposal by Martine the most, which is, let's organize a student challenge, which should result in a new facility for the Science Center. And I think it's a great idea. I hope that you have been inspired by this presentation, and I would gladly share the benefits of this check with you to such an extent that I will no longer have anything to spend, but there will be a nice idea for